folks. Just wanted to begin the evening. We have an amazing speaker as part of the REU program that LSU has and as part of the overall research experience for undergraduate programs. And there is not a whole lot I can say to introduce Dr. Gabriela Gonzalez. She's LSU's newest member of the National Academy of Sciences and a member of, recently elected member of the Academy of Arts and, American Academy of Arts and Sciences. And she won a National Academy of Sciences Award for Scientific Discovery. She's part of the LIGO Scientific Collaboration and was the longest serving elected spokesman. And I don't think I can say anything more to probably the most famous scientist in the Southern United States, so. Thank you.
Thank you. It's very nice to be here talking about things you probably have heard before, but I just wanted to put the history together and the latest news too. And this is a very long history. It started more than a billion years ago. There were two black holes that were orbiting around each other, and they were getting closer and closer together and warping space-time around them while dancing a tango. I'm from Argentina, so I like to say they were dancing a tango that was accelerating until they finally merged into a single black hole, and in the process emitted gravitational waves, these ripples of space-time that traveled more than a billion years until they got to Earth in 2015. But let me start the story, not when this started, that was, like I said, a billion years ago. On Earth, there were just multicellular organisms getting organized. So let's zoom over all of the early human history and jump to Einstein. In the 1900s, in the early 1900s, he developed this special theory of relativity that had this speed of light as the ultimate speed. Nothing travels faster than the speed of light. And that explained a lot of things in electricity and magnetism with relative motions and some conflicts that occur. But then he realized that that was incompatible with this beautiful theory of gravity that Newton had. The idea that gravity is an instantaneous force between masses goes against this idea that everything travels at the speed of light or slower. So he developed, and that took a bit longer, that took 10 years after the special theory of relativity, he developed this theory of general relativity, which is the theory of gravity. So the idea is, this should be a movie, the idea is that we live in a grid of space-time which is not rigid. The masses change this grid. They stretch and squeeze the grid, and the other masses, or every mass, travels in space-time following that curvature. So they don't move, masses, the sun, the earth, we when we fall on the ground, we are not responding to this instantaneous force of gravity, we are following the curvature of space-time. The earth is curving the space-time around it, and that's a force that we feel. The sun curves space-time around it, and that's why the earth goes around the sun. So this was a very complicated theory to explain something that everybody knew how it worked. Newton's theory, everybody knew how it worked. It explained lots of things beautifully. So what were the consequences of this theory? There were quite a few consequences, and they were all very surprising. Of course, it predicted the same things that Newton's theory did, including explaining a bit better the motion of Mercury around the sun, so that was the first success. But there were quite a few other predictions. The first one, and that was the first one that was measured, this was a theory, it was kind of a crazy theory, very mathematical theory, so we needed predictions to be proven by experiment. And the first one is that light traveling in curved space-time does not travel in a straight line. It follows the curved space-time. So that means that when light from a star travels near the sun to the Earth, it's not going to follow a straight line, and the apparent position of the star is going to be different during the day than during the night. Because during the day, the light goes near the sun, and during the night, the sun is on the other side of the Earth, and then the star seems to be in a different position. Of course, we don't see the stars during the day, except next August 21st, except during an eclipse. During an eclipse is when you can see the stars during the day. And that's what Eddington did in 1919, and that measured the position of stars that had an apparent position near the sun, and compared that position with the position of the same stars during the night, and confirmed that the apparent position was different. That was the first time that the theory of relativity was in the front page of the New York Times, 1919. There were other predictions, one crazier than the others. Another prediction was that the universe is not static. If you have mass in the universe, if you imagine that just for simplification, there is just dust in the universe, mass in small particles, so it's full of dust, then it turns out that the space-time is curved because of that dust, and it's either expanding or contracting. It's not static. But everybody knew at the time, this was 1915 when Einstein published the theory of relativity, everybody knew that the sky was static. The stars were always in the same place, except for the planets. So Einstein added a term to his equations to make the universe have some strange kind of energy that kept the universe static. It was only a couple of decades later that astronomers, actually less than a couple of decades later, that astronomers measured positions of stars and actually other galaxies, and they proved that the universe is expanding. All the galaxies are moving away from our galaxy. And it's not because they don't like us, it's because everything is moving away from everything else. The universe is not that static, it is expanding. So Einstein had to take that equation, that term away from his equations. He called it the largest blunder of his career because his equations, the original equations, predicted that the universe was expanding. Another prediction is that if you assume that you have mass and a spherical symmetry, which is the first thing that we usually do in physics courses, we assume the simplest symmetry that there could be, and that is spherical symmetry, then that mass would compactify into a compact object. Actually, all the mass would end up in a single point at which the equations would break down, but that single point would have a sphere, a geometrical sphere around it that we call horizon, and it would hide everything inside. If we now imagine light that falls into the black hole would never come out of the black hole. And anything that falls into a black hole would never come out of the black hole. And there are several other crazy things that happen if you get close to the black hole or if you fall into a black hole, although less crazy than in the movies, that the movies try to show. This was actually found not by Einstein himself, but by another physicist that was looking at his equations. His name was Schwarzschild, and he was fighting in the First World War. And he actually got sick during the war, and it was while being sick in a hospital bed that he solved these equations in 1916, the year after the theory was published. But at the time, people thought that this was a cute solution to these complicated equations. This was a very mathematical theory. This was a very mathematical solution. Nature would never produce such strange things. This one took several decades until astronomers began finding evidence that there indeed exist black holes. There are times in which you see a lot of mass in a small place and you don't see that as a star. It's not emitting light. You see things happening around it that happen very fast, and those things are emitting light. We know about these black holes because the matter around them emits X-rays, so we know about these black holes from X-ray astronomy. We also know it because sometimes we see stars that go around this dark spot, so we know that there's something at the center producing the motion of these stars, and that's how we know that at the center of our galaxy there is a black hole. We don't see any emission, or we see very weak emission from this black hole compared to other galaxies, but we know from these stars that we have a black hole of about 3 million solar masses at the very center of our galaxy. So black holes do exist, but Einstein didn't know about them. He actually died before there was any evidence of existence of black holes. And the one that I think is the craziest one is about time. His theory talks about space-time distortions. Space-time is curved. That means that clocks cannot be synchronized. If you have clocks at different distances from the Earth, for example, then the space-time, including time, will be less curved if you are farther away than closer to the Earth. So the clocks will run at different speeds. If you start with clocks synchronized here, and then one of you goes to some high mountain, then that clock is going to run faster than the clock down here. And that, again, took quite a while to be measured. These effects are very small, but now it's not only very well proven, experimentally proven, but also something that you are probably all using every day. It turns out that we need to take this effect into account to make GPS work to the precision that we are used to. Because how do we use GPS? We triangulate positions of GPS satellites with our clock here, but they are at different heights. So this effect is important if you really don't want to get lost and go to the wrong block. So there were many predictions. The one prediction that I'm most interested in telling you about is gravitational waves. The idea is that if you have two stars, for example, if you have in general a system, masses that are moving, then space-time will be also moving. This curvature will be changing in time. And those are gravitational waves. But they will also be carrying energy away, so they will make these stars get closer and closer. This is something that Einstein himself realized. He published a paper in 1916. About these gravitational waves, but he also made a small calculation saying these effects are so small that they will never be measured. He was wrong. So Einstein sometimes was wrong. This was a paper in 1916, and there were a few mistakes in that paper. He actually corrected some of those mistakes and made some, a few others in another paper in 1918, showing how the gravitational waves could be produced by different masses. But you might think, because it has been in the news, that this prediction was not experimentally proven until last year, announced at least last year, proven with the detection in 2015. That's not quite right. We knew about gravitational waves because for systems like this, in which we have two stars that are rotating and getting closer to each other, sometimes these stars are neutron stars, and sometimes one, and sometimes both of these stars, emit radio beams. These are called pulsars, and they're called pulsars because when we are lucky and we are on Earth oriented in such a way that this radio beam comes through us, we are only going to see pulses, radio pulses, and that's why these are called pulsars. And that's because the star is rotating around an axis, but the axis of the radio beam is a different one. So the radio beam is doing this. So if we are on Earth, then we see tick, tick, tick. In fact, Jocelyn Bell, the astronomer who first saw these pulses, called them little green men, because it was so regular that one could imagine, jokingly, I don't think she ever really thought that this was a foreigner, an alien civilization. Anyway, we know a lot about these neutron stars from measuring these radio beams with radio telescopes. And the first binary system, the first binary pulsar, was detected by Joe Taylor, a very famous astronomer, and Roger Hertz, his graduate student, who was measuring these ticks, 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 waiting for some distortion that indicated that there was another star in there, and this was a binary system, not just a single star. That was detected in the 70s. The system was detected in the 70s. And immediately they realized that they were close enough, the orbit was an 8-hour orbit, that the emission of gravitational waves should make them come closer. And one of the things that one can measure with these radio signals is how close the stars are. So this is a plot. Each point in here is a measurement of how close the stars are. And this is showing that they are getting closer and closer. And the solid line is the prediction of general relativity just using that the system is losing energy to gravitational waves. It took years. Notice the scale in here. It starts in 75. I think it was 74 when the system was first measured. This goes up to 2000. But it was in 93, around here, when actually the Arecibo telescope that was taking this data was taking a break, going through an upgrade, so they have all this data. And this earned them, Hertz and Taylor, a Nobel Prize. So gravitational waves were known to exist. The effect had been seen, and it had earned already a Nobel Prize. So this was not something that needed to be proven again. What we wanted to do, or the people in the 70s wanted to do, was to measure the effect of these gravitational waves in the space-time near the Earth, to measure it directly, to learn about the objects that were producing the gravitational waves. And again, I'm trying to follow the history here. It was in the 70s when people began thinking about measuring these with interferometers. So how do you do? You have a laser, it splits in two through a beam splitter, and then it goes to this mirror, it goes to that mirror, and then we have light coming at the output. If these two distances are the same, then the light, which is a wave, when it comes back, the two waves that are going to be interfering here are going to cancel each other. But if there is a gravitational wave, then this distance is going to change with respect to this distance. One is going to get longer, the other is going to get shorter, and these waves are not going to cancel each other. So if we have a photodiode in here, and we measure the light on that photodiode, and there is a gravitational wave, then we are going to see more light, less light. That is going to tell us that there's a gravitational wave. That was the idea. Again, in the 70s, people were proposing this and other methods of measuring gravitational wave. This turned out to be the most sensitive one. Now, how sensitive do these detectors need to be? Well, that's when Einstein was right, because these gravitational waves, the effect of these waves, is really, really small. The effect of those black holes I was telling you before is changing distances. The gravitational waves are changing distances all over the universe. The amplitude of the gravitational wave decreases with distance as 1 over the distance. So the effect is measured not in meters for distance changes, but in strain, because the prediction is that distances are going to change an amount proportional to that distance. So if you have a longer distance, it's going to change more than if you measure a shorter distance. So again, 2 big black holes that we measured, how big is the effect? Well, it's going to change the distance between the Earth and the Sun by 1 atomic diameter. That's a part in 10 to the 21. 10 to the minus 21 means that that distance, 1 astronomical unit, is going to change by 1 atomic diameter. And any smaller distance is going to change a lot less, proportionally less. So some people in the 70s believed you could use interferometers. Some people said, that's crazy. You're never going to get that sensitive. But the calculations showed that if you make the interferometers long enough, and if you use technology that didn't exist yet, now this was in the 90s, if you put in their technology at the time, then you would have noise at the level of 10 to the minus 21, but not, you wouldn't quite be able to see signals. But because it was going to take many years to build this, then there was going to be advances in technology, and then a second generation of detectors would be able to see this. Sounds like a crazy plan, a crazy long-term scientific plan. We are not very used to think about long-term plans, especially in today's climate, but NSF did at that time. In the 90s, the National Science Foundation paid for the construction of 2 observatories, 1 very close to us in Livingston, Louisiana, another in Hanford, Washington, with 4 kilometers on the side. 4 kilometer long vacuum systems in which we have laser interferometers working. That was an expensive enterprise. Why 2, you would think? You need 2 because the signals that you want to measure are so small that the only way to confirm them is to see them in 2 detectors. If these are astrophysical signals and not local signals, then they are going to come to the 2 detectors within 10 milliseconds. The light travel time between the 2 observatories is 10 milliseconds. Now, 4 kilometers is a lot shorter than the distance between the Earth and the Sun. So how small is 10 to the minus 21 times 4 kilometers? Well, that arithmetic is not too difficult, so you probably have done it in your heads already. That's about 4 10 to the minus 18 meters. What you might not remember is that the proton is 10 to the minus 15 meters. So we are talking about 4 parts in 1,000 as a difference, 4 parts in 1,000 of a proton diameter as the difference between those 4 kilometers and these 4 kilometers. It sounded crazy, but it wasn't. It took years, and it took many people. There was not just the institutions that built these observatories, Caltech and MIT, but also the creation of the LIGO Scientific Collaboration. It started in 97. It started here at LSU. I was not at LSU then, but in 1997, LSU organized the meeting in which scientists created the LIGO Scientific Collaboration. I was coming to that meeting as a young professor in Penn State before I moved here. Nowadays, the LIGO Scientific Collaboration has more than 1,000 scientists in 15 countries from more than 90 different institutions. And that's what it needs to get this technology and this project going and going successfully. Now, the other thing is knowing what to look for. That makes things easier. And one of the things that we talked about was signals produced by stars rotating around each other, stars or black holes. This is a numerical relativity simulation. Numerical relativity is also done here at LSU, but this one is from the SXS collaboration. So this is a space-time near the two black holes, but also the distortion of space-time far away from the black holes. That is what was so challenging to do it at such different scales. So here you see the two black holes merging, space-time going crazy near the black holes, but then settling down, and in the end you have a single rotating black hole. You have these gravitational waves going away, telling the rest of the universe about this embrace. Now, this is what the signal looks like. In the beginning, when the two black holes are orbiting around each other, it looks like a sine wave. A sine wave with twice the orbital frequency. But then, as they are getting closer, then the sine wave has a higher frequency. Notice how the period is a bit shorter here than here, and then shorter and shorter, and the amplitude is getting larger until they merge, and when they merge, then it settles down. The signal rings down to zero, because once we have a spherical black hole, there are no more gravitational waves emitted. The black hole is rotating, but there are no gravitational waves. Spherical matter does not produce gravitational waves. But what was a surprise, these simulations were only possible around 2005 or so. Before then, they were too challenging. It took a lot of tries to get to find the methods to produce these simulations. But look at how simple this is. It looks very simple. That was a surprise. Everybody thought that since space-time goes so crazy near the black holes, then this had to be crazy too. But it's not. It's relatively simple. So we knew what to look for if we wanted black holes in general for two stars. We know what to look for before the merger. We look for a sine wave that increases in amplitude and frequency. This is the technology that we use to get to that precision of 10 to the minus 21. There's a lot of technology, and I'm showing here the technology that we are using in the advanced LIGO detectors that were installed in 2008 and began operating in 2015 or so. But there was a previous generation, initial LIGO detectors, that had less sensitivity, and it was simpler technology, and those operated between 2005 and 2010. So it has taken about 20 or 30 years to get to this. So what do we have here? I told you that we use a Michelson interferometer. It's not quite so simple. The laser has to travel in vacuum so that the air doesn't make the light follow a curved path. So this is a vacuum tube, ultra high vacuum. This is the one of the largest vacuum volumes in the world. It's inside an enclosure, a concrete enclosure, protecting it from the wind, from bullets, from storms, from hurricanes. And the sites have survived all of that. These sites were built in the early 90s, and we are in 2017 now. The mirrors at the end are not just simple mirrors bolted to an optical table. We need these mirrors not to move with seismic noise, because if they move with seismic noise, then we will see signals out here, which will not be gravitational waves. It will be seismic noise. So we hung this big mirror, this big heavy mirror, from glass fibers, from another mirror, which is hanging from blades, which is hanging from blades, which is hanging from a seismic isolation systems in which we have three layers of metal with sensors that measure the distance, the relative motion between the layers, and cancel it. This is called an active seismic isolation system. And then we have this quadruple pendulum hanging from this seismic isolation system, and all of that inside vacuum chambers. Everything is in vacuum. The mirrors themselves are just state of the art in the material that is produced, that the glass that they are produced with, the polishing, the coating. We use glass fibers, and we use this very special, well, it's fused silica, but it's very special fused silica, because we are also sensitive to the Brownian motion of these mirrors. And we don't work at low temperatures, because that makes everything even more difficult. We work at room temperature, but the way we get away from Brownian motion limiting our sensitivity is by having very little loss in the systems. If there is very little energy dissipation, then it turns out that most of the Brownian motion is concentrated on very narrow frequencies, and then away from the other frequencies, from our frequency band in which we want to be sensitive. The laser is a high power laser. And I should mention too that this is not just NSF now. The UK Science and Technology Facilities Council invested money even before NSF did in Advanced LIGO to produce these suspension systems. And the Max Planck Institute in Germany invested in producing the technology for these laser systems. So this was now an international project, not just because of the collaboration, but because of the hardware. So we have a 200 watts laser. We only had a 20 watts laser in initial LIGO, so this is 10 times more powerful, and that also helps with the quantum noise of the light. So this is very, very difficult to put all together. But in 2015, notice that we started putting this in 2008, in 2015, now we're getting closer to the present, we didn't quite yet have the sensitivity that we wanted with these detectors. It takes years of very hard work to make these detectors as sensitive as they can be, getting to their fundamental limits. But we had a distance reach to these binary systems more than three times better we had ever been with the initial generation. We want to be 10 times better. For these binary neutron star systems, not black holes, but binary neutron star systems with initial LIGO, we could see about 20 megaparsecs away. In 2015, we had a sensitivity to see them at around 60, 70 megaparsecs. So we had planned this, and we said, well, we are not going to wait until we get to 200 megaparsecs. That's our goal. We are just going to stop here, take data for a little while. We probably won't see anything, but we'll learn to take data. We'll write a few papers, and then we'll keep working on the instrument. But even before we started taking data 24/7, on September 14 of 2015, That was Monday, around 5 a.m. here in Louisiana. 7 milliseconds later in Hanford, we saw this. So this plot is showing in blue the light on this photodetector in Livingston, Louisiana. And this is the normal level of the noise. Notice the axis in here. This is 10 to the minus 21, 10 to the minus 1, 10 to the minus 21. So you can see the light getting brighter and darker, brighter and darker. And this is the usual noise that we see in the data. And we are using just a minimal filtering here. But then in blue, you see this sine wave that grows in amplitude and frequency, and then it rings out. And in Hanford, in this photo detector in Hanford, 3,000 kilometers away, but only 7 milliseconds later, we saw this signal, the one in orange, which has been shifted to make it coincide with the one in Livingston, doing the same thing. We just couldn't believe it. This is not the way we look for gravitational waves. We don't have graduate students looking at filter data on the screen saying, oh, look, that looks like a gravitational wave. We actually have sophisticated computer algorithms that produce web pages that you have to check, signals that tell you, well, there seems to be something here, there's nothing here, you should look at this. So we were not yet taking data, so we did not have alerts set up. Nowadays, when there is an interesting coincidence produced by these computer algorithms, I receive text messages. Mm-hmm. And more than half the time, those are not real. So quite a bit more than half the time. But we didn't have any of that set up at this time. So this was just too good to be true. That's what we thought in the beginning. We didn't think this was real. We thought somebody had injected these signals, had pushed the mirror, simulated gravitational waves, which is something we do all the time to test our systems. Also, notice the time scaling here. This was only a fraction of a second, 0.2 seconds. So these are frequencies that are relatively low if these were going to be neutron stars. So we thought, we concluded, actually, after a lot of work, that these were black holes, and big black holes, almost 30 solar masses each, forming a 60 solar mass at the end. And we know that because if you look at the waveform that I showed you before from numerical relativity, different masses produce different frequencies, different distances produce different amplitudes, and then you have to do a lot more work. But you can see that, and the noise distorts then the signal. So you can see, this is just an approximation, but you can see that it was a total mass of around 60 solar masses at about 400 megaparsecs. Again, to get the actual numbers and the actual errors takes a lot more than this cute movie. But from the beginning, we could tell these were not binary neutron stars. These things were not in our galaxy. These were big black holes out there in the universe. 400 megaparsecs is 1.3 billion light years. Quite a far distance. So it took us months to convince ourselves that this was true. We wrote a paper, a short paper, and several other longer papers with the details. We sent it for review, and we had actually set a tentative date for a press conference if we got the review. We got the review back. We sent the paper on January 21st, and we got the reviews within a week. And they were positive. They asked for small changes, but they were positive. So we were ready on February 11 to announce to the world that we had seen gravitational waves from black holes. I was so happy to be there. I was a spokesperson. I was wearing an LSU pin. You might see if you see the video. But we also had, directing the press conference was the director of the National Science Foundation, Franz Cordova, Dave Reitze was the one who said, ladies and gentlemen, we did it. He's the executive director of the LIGO laboratory, and Ray Wise and Kip Thorne, who were two of those pioneers who in the 70s began thinking about interferometers to measure gravitational waves from black holes, and in the 90s convinced the NSF, together with Ron Driver, who was in Caltech and has sadly deceased a few months ago, to pay for this project. In the 90s, it took 20, almost 30 years to get here. Now, I'm going to tell you more about the science that follows, but I have to say that the public reaction to this was amazing. It was all kind of questions and interest, the public interest that was amazing. But the two examples that I like the best to illustrate this is this ad that appeared in the subway in New York City. Scientists found gravitational waves in outer space. If only it were that easy to find an apartment in New York City with a walk-in closet. That's an ad for storage space. Gravitational waves had made it to the ads. you can't get more public than that. And the other example that, again, had nothing to do with us, this was not LIGO people, was a dress. A dress with a gravitational waveform. I have it. It doesn't look that nice on me, but you can find pictures of me wearing it. So gravitational waves made it to the general public, not just to the scientific community. And that was actually really nice. Now, who was we? When we said we did it, it was this LIGO scientific collaboration and the Virgo collaboration. This is a European collaboration that has a European detector in Italy that with which we plan to take data together. And when you see this number of logos, people say, oh, that sounds so many people. But you really have to think that each of these logos is a large group of people. And what you also need to think, which I think it's not so common, is that when you think of physics and Einstein and gravitational waves, you think of Einstein, you think of the early scientists working on this. This is Joe Weber in the University of Maryland with another way of detecting gravitational waves, Kip Thorne and Ray Wise, Ray Wise and Peter Scholson. This is my PhD advisor, and I love that picture because these are my two mentors. And if you think of physicists, you tend to think of people like this. Men, middle-aged, gray hair, no hair, but this is the LIGO people, and these are your real physicists. Physicists look like you. They look like everybody. We come in all colors, all shapes, men, women, young, senior. We all do this together, and you need all of this to get to where we got. So let me go back to the science. We started taking data in September 2015. We were going to take data for a few months. We took data until January. We saw this big signal on September 14th from these two black holes, 29 and 36 solar masses, merging into a 62 solar mass black hole. So let me say that again. 29 plus 36 equals 62. Now, I see a mathematician here, and he hasn't said anything, but 29 plus 36 is not 62, it's 65, but that's because there are three solar masses that were converted into energy following this famous Einstein formula, E equal mc squared. Three solar masses were converted into energy that the gravitational waves carried away. So there was less mass at the end than at the beginning, but the total energy was the same. But that was not the only thing we saw. In December 26, it was actually still December 25th, Christmas evening in the US, we saw another signal from smaller black holes. These were 14 and 8 solar masses. Because they were smaller, then the signal is smaller amplitude. They were at about the same distance, so the amplitude is a bit smaller, but they merge at the larger frequency, so the signal is a bit longer. It's almost a second long. And we even saw another thing, a candidate, that looks like the coalescence of black holes, but this might have been produced by the noise we estimate maybe once every couple of years. So maybe once every couple of years, just random noise in the detectors produces a signal like this. So I don't believe it that much. The only things that makes it plausible is that we have seen two similar signals before and after. These signals, we call them detections because the chance that these are produced by random noise, it's less than once every 100,000 years. It's actually 200,000 years for this biggest one. So we are very, very confident about those. Not so much about this one. We like to say that we are beginning to listen to gravity's music, to Einstein's symphony, and that we have heard the first two notes. And you might have heard this in YouTube already. How many people here have heard this chirp? Okay, I see quite a few hands. Let me test if this is what you heard. Let me play it here. I'm playing the two signals, the longer one first, and the shorter one second. Again. Is that what you heard? Well, it might have been. It's actually not what we usually make people listen to because it's kind of boring. These frequencies are low frequencies. These are 100 to 200 hertz, so they are a low pitch. It's not very musical, even though that is what you hear if you put the signal on a speaker. So what we have done is taking lessons from astronomers. You are probably used to see these beautiful pictures of X-rays and ultraviolet and infrared, which is not visible. Astronomers fake the colors. They use false coloring to make those beautiful images. So we said, well, we'll add 400 hertz to this. So this is what we call increased pitch. And this chirp is famous. Actually, this short one was played recently by a House representative in an NSF hearing in Congress. He played it on his phone. That's how famous that chirp is. But now you know the truth. Okay. Those were the first two notes. That was 2015, early 2016. We are now mid-2017. What has happened since then? Well, we took time to work on the detectors, and we make one detector quite a bit better, the other one not so much. So in the first observing run, we saw those two signals, and we had a range to these binary neutron star systems, which would be around 70 megaparsecs. In the second observing run that we started on November 30th last year, and it's going to continue until end of August, we had between 60 and 100 megaparsecs. So one of the detectors was better, the other one not so much. And we already saw a signal. We have already confirmed and published about the signal, again from the coalescence of black holes, on January 4th, 2017. We are still analyzing the data that we have collected, so there might be more. We actually have sent, I forget now, 8 or 9 triggers. These are candidates to astronomers for them to follow up with telescopes and satellites, but we use a very, very low threshold, a very low significance for those, just in case, since we don't have many anyway. And the plan for the future is, first, there's going to be another detector joining the run. This is the Virgo detector. And now we have, until recently, this was a TBD, but now we have a firm date. They are going to join August 1st, so that's next week. And then we are going to stop again. We're going to not just work on improving the detectors, but install some new technology that's ready to improve the sensitivity. We think that we might be around 150 megaparsecs by perhaps mid-2018 or so. We'll take data for 9 months or so. If we really are at this sensitivity, we might see for the first time the coalescence of a binary neutron star system. That is amazing, because we would see a black hole being born. It's the two neutron stars merging to form a black hole. More likely, we'll see first a neutron star and a black hole forming a bigger black hole. But these are important, because when you have that kind of systems, then they not only emit gravitational waves, but because a neutron star has matter in there, it emits light. It emits X-rays, gamma rays. So we might be able to see and hear that signal. And that would be amazing. And then we keep working. As I told you, these detectors have the capability of seeing these systems 200 megaparsecs away. When we reach that sensitivity, we'll probably see several coalescences of neutron stars per year. And now we know tens of coalescences of black holes per year. So it is an era of real astronomy. These are the three papers, the three detections I talked to you about. The first one's from 01, the second one from January. It took several months to confirm it. Like you see, we published it in June. Notice the names. We were not very imaginative with the names. So the first observation, we didn't put it in the title, but it's GW150914. That's a date. So the second one was GW151226, and this one is GW170104. We have been told by the International Astronomical Union that GW is actually an acronym for Galactic Worms, but we think we'll stick with this name. Now, we are saying that this is astronomy already, and I want to show you why we say this. Before this, we knew about these big black holes at the center of galaxies. Those are million or billion solar mass black holes. But those are too big for us to see signals from there. We have a sensitive frequency band between 10 hertz and a few kilohertz. So we can see coalescences of smaller objects, like neutron stars, or small black holes. And about small black holes, or solar mass black holes, we knew about them from X-ray studies, because sometimes the black hole, the matter around the black hole, emits jets in X-ray. This is not light coming out of the black hole. It's atoms that are going around the black hole and very fast, and it's the radiation of that matter before it falls into the black hole. And sometimes we see a star, a regular star, and from the light of that regular star, we can tell that there is a black hole as a companion. So we knew about a few black holes. They all had less than 20 solar masses. For some of those, we could measure how fast they rotate, and that was all we knew. But now, this is what we know. We learned about this first detection that had two bigger black holes than all the previously one known, forming an even bigger one. The December one was a regular one, a vanilla one, like we want to say now. The January 4th was in between these, but this was quite a bit farther away. This was almost twice as far away as these two signals. And there is this candidate too, which is somewhere in between. So now we know not only that there are bigger black holes, but they exist in binary systems and they merge. That's not trivial, because for two stars to find each other, they have to travel quite a bit. It's finding each other by chance in a space that's all empty is not trivial. So astronomers are actually working quite hard to understand how these systems get formed. But when you think of astronomy, you think about pointing to the sky and saying, that's where we saw something. Now that, unfortunately, is not quite what we do, because with two detectors, you cannot quite triangulate. You have some information, like with your 2 ears, but in general, you can only tell the position in the sky in a ring, and then you can tell that one half of the ring is more likely than the other one from the phase and amplitude of the signals that you see. But this is how well we could localize that first detection, which has been the strongest we have seen so far. And that's not very precise. There are tons and tons of stars and galaxies in the sky. Although to me, this looks like a smiley, so I love this image. But we want to do better. So how can we do better? With more detectors. This is the same ring. This is that ring for that first detection. This is for the candidate. This is for December, and this is for the January detection. This, as you can see, these are much poorer localized than that first one. But if we have more detectors, and we will, then we will be able to localize better these signals. As I told you, Virgo is going to join us, but Virgo, just like LIGO Hanford and LIGO Livingston, we are still working on getting to the sensitivity that we need, so they are going to be improving over the years in sensitivity. There's another detector in construction in Japan called Kagra. That's a cryogenic underground detector. It probably will begin taking data 2020 or so. And then we have an observatory that's about to begin construction in India, and that's going to begin taking data around 2024 or so. So we will have a network of detectors. In the next 10 years, every year, we're going to have a better network. And look at the difference that the network does. This is what we saw for those detections. This is a simulation of the localization if we only had Virgo on at those times. So again, notice the difference from that to this. Look at the small circle for that loud signal. That's what we want. And we not only are looking for this chirp sound, we are looking for several kinds of different music. We are looking for these coalescence binary systems, not just from black holes, but neutron stars, like I said, but we are also looking for generic transients without assuming any model. And this is what we want to do. This is what we need to do if we want to see signals from supernovae, because those are very difficult to simulate, but this is also what we can use to learn the unknown. So that is the most exciting search, if you ask me. We are also looking for continuous signals that are slowly modulated, and those would be produced by spinning neutron stars in our galaxy. So that's a continuous sound with a slow modulation. Imagine all the music you can hear with this. And we are also looking for a rumble. That's a rumble of noise that is correlated in the two detectors and would be produced by the early universe, for example, although much more likely, by many, many different events, perhaps unknown events, but certainly these coalescing systems that are too far away to produce strong signals, but all together produce a rumble, a stochastic background. So we are looking for all of these. We have published about these in our first observing run, and we have not found anything yet. Well, we have not found anything in that first run. We looked for pulsars, we looked for neutron stars, we looked for a stochastic background. There was nothing there, but we'll keep looking. And this is not the only frequency for gravitational waves. larger black holes produce gravitational waves of lower frequency. And we know those black holes exist. Those are the ones at the center of the galaxy. So how do we look for those? We need a longer baseline, a million kilometer baseline. That's a space project. It's called LISA. It's been approved by the European Space Agency. It has a launching date of 2034, but we think it's going to launch sooner than that. If you want to see the billion mass black hole systems, then you need to have even longer baseline. And for that, you can use the radio beams coming from these pulsars, and you can look for phase correlation between those. And then you have an interferometer of galactic scale. That's called pulsar timing. And we think that there should be observations appearing in these detectors in the next few years, certainly in the next decade, but I think it's going to be a lot sooner than that. And we can even look for the early universe, although for that, we really have to resort to other techniques, for example, looking at the cosmic microwave background. So there's a lot of music coming from different sources, from different wavelengths, and it's all coming to you very soon. Thank you.